If you're struggling with gas and bloating, irritable bowel syndrome, or any of the other myriad of conditions that affect an estimated 1 in 5 of us, you're probably overwhelmed with all the conflicting information around dietary fiber, probiotics, prebiotics, and fermented foods. It can be really frustrating because in your attempt to fix your problem, you try a new supplement or a new food, and it often makes it worse. And you end up getting so frustrated, you don't know what to do. If you can relate, this video is for you. We'll start off talking about your microbiome, what it is, why it's so important. Number two, we'll talk about dietary fiber, the challenges of our modern food system, and also how you can potentially fix it. Number three, we'll talk about probiotic supplements if you'd like to go that route. And lastly, we'll talk about the complexities of fermented foods. My name is Lucas. I'm a yoga teacher and a nutritional coach. About 11 years ago, I actually formulated and used to distribute probiotic supplements. In working with my formulator and researchers, I learned a lot about gut health. That's what I'd like to share with you here today. Just to clarify, I am not a doctor and I also have nothing to sell you. I'm not going to do any specific product recommendations. My objective is just to share with you what I've learned so hopefully you can make choices that will help to heal your gut. If in doubt, please go see a doctor. A good gastroenterologist can really, really help. Please err on the side of caution. Before we get started, one quick ask of you. Hit subscribe down below. It helps to support the channel. Just takes a moment. Secondly, down below in the description, you will find a PDF link with a list of foods that can be really helpful and some of the other key topics that we'll cover in this video. Let's start off talking about your microbiome. Here's what it is. Inside your gut, especially your large intestine, your colon, we have 3 pounds of bacteria, viruses, fungi, and other microorganisms. In fact, there are trillions with a T of different microorganisms, and on a cell-by-cell basis, you're actually more bacteria than you are human. They're just a lot smaller in terms of their cellular size. What this means is we have 1,000 different microorganisms in terms of diversity. Very, very complex area of the body, complex area of study, and there's way more that we don't know than we do know. But here's what we do know. These bugs are responsible for your mood, for your digestion, for the creation of things like B vitamins, vitamin K, a lot of amino acids. Your gut is largely responsible for your immune system, your tolerance or intolerance to specific foods. There are so many different things that your microbiome does. This is why it's so crucial to health. Because of the complexity and the diversity in our modern food supply, it's also very prone to dysbiosis or imbalance, where these bad bugs outnumber our good bugs, and then we can really struggle. A lot of this comes back to fiber, which is our next topic. When you look at the diet of Neolithic or Paleolithic man, it's really hard to figure out exactly what they were eating, but most estimates are that our ancestors that we evolved from were eating upwards of 50, 60, even 70 grams of fiber per day. Whereas most Americans are eating 10 or 15 grams of fiber. So that's way less food for their gut. There are 3 main types of fiber you need to know about. They're all really important. The first one is soluble fiber, water soluble. Think of this as a gel-like substrate that moves through you and ferments, and it turns into short chain fatty acids that are very important for your gut health and your overall health, things like butyrate. We then have insoluble fiber. Think of these like twigs or like a corn kernel. They blast right through you. They help to keep you regular. That's really important. And then the last category of fiber that's not talked about enough are called prebiotics. And these are in things like onions and garlic. And these prebiotics are a non-digestible type of fiber that actually feeds your good bugs. We need soluble, insoluble, and prebiotic fibers all the time, and we need a lot more. When people hear about that, that our ancestors ate 4 or 5 times as much fiber, they think, well, that's easy enough to solve. I'll go buy some psyllium husk, or I'll eat a bunch of apples or beans or nuts or whatever it is. Boom, problem solved. Unfortunately, if you go from eating 15 grams of fiber a day to 60 grams of fiber a day, so 4x, you're really gonna feel that. This is a recurring theme in gut health and gut healing, is sometimes things get worse before they get better. And if you go too quickly into a very high fiber diet, I promise you, you'll spend tomorrow on the toilet. So whether it's fiber or probiotics or any of the other things we'll talk about, it's really important that you take baby steps and allow yourself time to ease into it. But yes, absolutely, you need to increase your fiber intake over time. The next topic to look at are probiotics. Sometimes probiotics are now added to energy bars, to sports drinks. They're added to super green drinks, powders that you might find at the health food store. And certainly you can find all kinds of different supplements, often very expensive and very complex to understand. There are a few things to consider. The first one is the strain choice and strain diversity. As I mentioned, you have over 1,000 different strains of microbes inside your gut, but commercially, in supplements and additives, you usually just find a handful available. Things like lactobacillus, bifidobacterium, saccharomyces boulardii, these are some of the common ones that you'll find. And again, 1,000 different strains and usually around 2, 3, 10, 12 different strains in commercial products. So obviously we're trying to laser target the ones that we know are good for you. My initial thought when it came to formulating supplements is I thought, let's get the most diversity and the strongest one possible, like a big sledgehammer, boom, let's fix our gut. That works sometimes. Sometimes it backfires. As I mentioned before, with fiber, if you go too much too soon, you can just have these really negative reactions. The same is true with nutritional supplements. Whether it's a probiotic that you buy over the counter or even a prescription that you get from your doctor, the strain diversity as well as the potency really varies, and you have to find some individual dosage that works for you. To give you an idea, if you're just getting started with probiotic supplements, I usually suggest people choose around 5 strains. So when you flip over the bottle and you read on the back, you want to see how many different strains are available, and around 5 is a good place to start. In terms of potency, probiotics are measured in terms of something called CFUs, colony forming units. And on the low end, you have 1 billion CFUs, colony forming units. Anything above 10 billion is quite strong. And some of the stuff, especially the pharmaceutical grade stuff, will be all the way at 70 billion plus. If you're taking 70 billion plus CFUs of probiotics, I promise you that your day tomorrow will involve a lot of trips to the bathroom. That doesn't necessarily mean it's the wrong thing, but like I mentioned before, that's like a big sledgehammer approach. Might be right for you, but probably for most people, easing into it makes the most sense. You do want to make sure that you have at least minimum potency of 1 billion CFUs. Some of the nutritional supplements, especially some of the superfood and energy bars, they put such a teeny tiny amount that it's not going to make any difference at all. So let's say we're aiming for around 5 strains. More or less. Let's say we're aiming for around 5 billion CFUs to get started. If you're working with a supplement, the last thing to think about is the storage. Now, with freeze-dry technology, most probiotic supplements now can be stored on the shelf for a long time, but some of them do require refrigeration, and some of the supplements you get from your doctor also require refrigeration. In all cases, whether refrigerated or not, you should use these up quickly, 3 months, 6 months max, because they'll lose their efficacy. These little bugs, they will die off and become inactive, and then they won't work at all. Probiotic supplements are expensive. Around $1 a day is a very common cost, and as you get up into higher potency and greater strain diversity, they become all the more expensive. So choose carefully, make sure that it works for you, and for many people, this is a short-term bridge to get their gut health back. To that end, let's talk finally about fermented foods. Fermented foods have been used for millennia. You find them in all cultures all around the world. That might be things like yogurt, it could be kefir, it could be sauerkraut, kimchi, fermented fish sauce, all kinds of different things. There is kombucha, kvass. You'll find fermented foods anywhere you go in the world, and there are two main types you need to think about. The first are wild ferments. These would be things you make at home, and the other would be controlled ferments. These are things you buy in the store. What's the difference? Well, if you made kombucha at home on your kitchen counter, which I've done, it's exposed to the mother, the bacteria that you add, but also all of the bacteria in the air. This can be good, this can be bad, it can be both good and bad. If you're struggling with gut dysbiosis, wild ferments are pretty risky. The same would be true if you go to a farmer's market and buy sauerkraut, for example, fermented cabbage that's been wild fermented in open air. Anything could be in there, and for a lot of people, that can trigger a very negative reaction. If you're struggling with gut problems, in the short term at least, I would encourage you to go down the controlled fermentation path. What that means is a commercial yogurt maker, a commercial sauerkraut maker, or kombucha maker, they're going to specifically inoculate their substrate with specific type of bacteria to control the fermentation process, and you're more likely to have a positive reaction. Now, there is a time and a place for wild ferments, but wait until your gut is healed. And to wrap things up, this is the challenge with healing your gut. Oftentimes, it will get worse before it gets better. And by worse, I mean more gas, more bloating, more loose stools, more trips to the bathroom. You should think in terms of 2 to 4 week blocks if you're testing something new. And in all cases, ease your way into it, meaning don't quadruple your fiber intake overnight. Don't slam yourself with tons and tons of probiotics, little by little, baby steps, and you should, month on month, start to feel significant gains. You don't want to rely on probiotic supplements long term. You do want to rely on whole food nutrition, on a diversity of fiber, and getting all of those fermented foods that naturally are working for you. Again, grab that list down below in the description. You'll find a PDF link. I think it'll be helpful. Remember to hit subscribe down below so you get my video next week. And if you'd like to train with me, I have a program called YOGABODY Daily, and we're focused on health span, which we refer to living your best life in the second half. To that end, we do strength and stretching and steps every day. There's a couple thousand people just like you. If you'd like to learn more about that program, you can find that at yogabody.com. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you in the next video.